Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to our 15th annual show. There is very little that needs to be said about Sherlock Holmes because we all believe that we already know everything about Sherlock Holmes, which is of course not true. Let me remind you that in Sherlock Holmes days there were no mobiles yet, so please switch your mobiles off. Thank you. Then we are going to bring you a most elementary Sherlock Holmes. We hope you will enjoy the show, and when you've enjoyed it, give freely afterwards. Thank you.
Watson, good morning. Watson.
What is it? I mean, what time is it?
7:15, I'm afraid.
Is the house on fire?
No. Very sorry to knock you up, Watson, but it's the common lot this morning. Mrs. Hudson has been knocked up. She retorted on me and I on you.
What is it then?
A client, or rather, a schoolgirl.
What?
Yes, I appreciate your fast take-in effect. It seems a very young lady arrived in a considerable state of excitement who insists upon seeing me. She's waiting now in the sitting room. Now, when young ladies wander about the metropolis at this hour of the morning and knock sleepy people up out of their bed, I presume it is something very pressing which they have to communicate. Should it prove to be an interesting case, you would, I'm sure, wish to follow it from the outset. I thought at any rate that I should call you and give you the chance.
I would not miss it. Or anything. Just give me a moment to dress. We can meet this very young lady in here. Have you any idea how young she is?
Mrs. Hudson said she can be hardly older than 14.
14? That's very young.
As I said, I have very little experience in talking with such children.
But Wiggins?
Wiggins is a boy and a street child. He's extraordinary and clever. This here's a common schoolgirl, I believe.
Well, perhaps the story is not so common. Let's have her in.
Good morning, madam. My name is Sherlock Holmes. This here is my friend and associate, Dr. Watson, before whom you can speak as freely as before myself. I am glad to see that Mrs. Hudson has had the good sense of lighting a fire. Shall I order you a cup of hot coffee, for I observe that you're shivering?
It is not cold which makes me shiver.
No, I see. It isn't. But you must not fear. We shall soon set matters right, I have no doubt. You come in by train this morning, I see.
How do you know?
I only observed the second half of a return ticket in the palm of your right glove. You must have started early, and yet you had a very good drive in a dog cart along heavy roads before you reached the station.
That is true, but how...
There is no mystery, my dear young madam. The left arm of your jacket is spattered with mud in no less than 7 places. The marks are perfectly fresh. There is no other vehicle but a dog cart, which throws up any mud in that particular way, and then only when you sit on the left-hand side of the driver.
Whatever your reasons may be, you are perfectly correct. I started from college before 6, reached Crowborough at 20 past, and came in by the first train. Sir, I can't stand this train no longer. I shall go mad if it continues.
Before 6 from college near Crowborough? Then it must be Charlton's Ladies, that college that you call your home.
That is true.
And you haven't had breakfast yet?
No, sir.
My dear Watson, will you please ring for Mrs. Hudson and ask her to send some breakfast up?
Of course.
I heard of you, Mr. Holmes. We have a very kind and experienced new singing mistress who told us she had met you and that you could solve any unusual mystery. She said you were brilliant and nearly never made a mistake.
Nearly never? Pray, tell me who this wonderfully critical person is to whom I owe your acquaintance.
Her name is Mrs. Norton, and she said you were best man at your wedding. Do you remember her?
Isn't that the marriage?
Yes, it is.
But that was 1888.
March 1888. I shall never forget it. It was like yesterday.
That woman. I thought she'd left the country for good.
So it is true? She came back half a year ago. Her husband died in an accident, and she wanted to return to the old country, where she had been happy, she said.
Irene Adler.
That was the name under which she was a famous opera star. But now she's our singing mistress, and really, you couldn't wish for a more experienced one.
I bet. And she suggested asking me about your mystery?
No, sir. She told our group about you some time ago on an outing. And when these strange things occurred, I remembered what she had told us.
Ah, then you should better begin with telling your own story. But, of course, after you had some milk and biscuits.
I had already prepared something. You gentlemen never think of the needs of girls or women.
Come, come, Mrs. Hudson, we're not all that bad.
But of course you are. Mr. Holmes never cared for women.
That is not totally correct.
And I was married, happily.
You never brought her here. I never seen her. So, what do I know?
She died too soon. Even my medical knowledge couldn't save her.
Anyway, this is only a girl. Be kind to her.
We intend to be.
She would make a good prefect at our school. Energetic and understanding.
Well, yes, which brings us back to the problem that brought you here at this very early hour of the morning, and probably without the knowing of your prefect, which will get you, and possibly us, into very serious trouble, unless you have a very good reason for it.
Best! My friend Maggie has disappeared, kidnapped.
Uh-huh.
Haven't you heard of it yet? I thought you heard of these things sooner than other people. Maggie, Lady Margaret in full, is the only daughter and heir of the Duke of Holderness. She disappeared 3 days ago.
Holderness? The former cabinet minister?
I think so.
Holderness, 6th Duke of KGPC. My God, how the alphabet of titles and honors. Baron of Beverley, Earl of Garston. My dear! Lord Lieutenant of Hallamshire. Cabinet minister until last year. First wife was Edith, the daughter of Sir Charles Appledore, now married to a considerably younger woman called Sylvia. Now, this woman is certainly one of the most important subjects of the crown.
And one of the richest and most generous. He has put up a reward for the finding of his daughter and her kidnappers. Did you not know that?
It has not been made public.
£5,000 for his daughter and £1,000 for the names of the kidnappers. He said it on the school corridor loudly before I threatened to have our headmistress fired unless Maggie reappeared quickly. Miss Riggs was quite excited and pulled him into her study, saying this was nothing for other people's ears. He laughed.
He laughed?
Bitterly. He stayed in her study for another 30 minutes, and it was very loud inside. Unfortunately, the doors are so thick you couldn't understand anything.
The police were called in.
No, nothing of the kind. The Duke's secretary and the teachers looked everywhere, but they found nothing. Or rather, something which they think explains everything.
Now, order and method. One step after the other. When was the disappearance discovered?
Maggie was last seen on Monday evening. She sleeps next door and you must walk from my room to get into hers. It was my job, being older than she is, to look after her. She's only 12 and only came to college last year. But she's friendly and nice and doing well. Everybody likes her.
Monday evening? What time about?
About 9 o'clock. The rooms are on the second floor. The next morning, her room was empty. Since she didn't leave through our room, she must have climbed out of the window. There is a tree growing close to the window. A set of clothes and her shoes were missing. Nobody believes that she has taken from her room. Somehow someone must have made her leave the room. Ever since that time, there has not been a sound or trace of her. I'm deeply worried.
Quite rightly. The police should have been called in. I should have been called earlier. 3 days is a long time. Too long to find reliable traces now. Now, what was the other thing that has been discovered? You mentioned that they found something which they think explains everything.
Indeed, our German teacher, Dr. Wagner, has also disappeared.
Anything about him?
He's been at our school for about 2 years. Good teacher, everybody says, but I don't like him. Too strict, and I don't like German anyway.
Might he have kidnapped her or convinced her to leave with him?
I don't think so. He wasn't young and not handsome or attractive. He didn't teach her. They hardly knew each other. It is all very strange, but he has been gone ever since then too.
And the police haven't been told about him either?
No one. I couldn't stand it any longer. This is dreadful. Margaret may be dead by now.
This is something we must take into account, yeah?
Oh, Mr. Holmes, if you're as brilliant as Mrs. Norton says, then you must help us. You must come and clear this whole thing up. You must save poor Maggie.
You like her very much?
I feel responsible.
How old are you?
14.
Too young to feel responsible. and yet you act more responsibly than your teachers in this case, and far too young to wander about the metropolis at this hour of the morning.
Someone had to do it.
Does anyone at your school know where you are?
My roommate, Lady Frances. Will you please come and help us find Maggie?
If she can be saved, I will save her. My dear fellow, will you please ring for Mrs. Hudson once more? You will wait at Mrs. Hudson's place below until we had our breakfast and packed a few things. We will accompany you home then.
Thank you very much, Mr. Holmes. It must also be a great pleasure for you to meet Mrs. Norton again.
A pleasure? Well, perhaps. We shall see. Mrs. Hudson, will you please take care of our guests and send some breakfast up? We will then be away for a few days.
I thought as much. Shall I order you a coach to the station?
In an hour's time, I should think.
All right, come along, me girl.
Yes, madam.
Breakfast?
Irene Adler.
Norton. This whole case is strange. It looks like a trap to me.
Trap? For who? For Lady Margaret?
For us.
What?
Yes, the game's afoot, my dear Watson, and the refusal of calling in the police is most extraordinary.
It's a ladies' college, Holmes.
I hope it's not one of those fighting for the right to vote and female emancipation crazy women they create.
I heard my wife talk about it once. She always said if we should have her daughter, she would love to send her there. Good sound education, lots of sports, lots of science, and a finishing school. Some of them have ended up as first female medicine students at Cambridge, and some of them have ended up marrying some of the richest men in the country. Of course, not everybody approves of female schooling.
Few women are capable of higher thought, medicine, and caring, perhaps.
Holmes, you're old-fashioned.
Or, according to my experience, look at it from my point of view. To be of interest for me, you must be a brilliant criminal committing a complicated crime. All those brilliant criminals I've ever met and found out were men. What does that tell you?
That they were less brilliant than you.
And that women are not brilliant enough for crime.
The fact that you have not yet encountered a female criminal does not prove anything.
I think I know every criminal in Britain, or nearly every criminal.
I put it to you that the only truly successful criminals are those who are not discovered. How can you be sure none of them is a woman? And the only criminal who ever escaped you was a woman.
She was not really a criminal.
But she was dangerous, and she tricked you. Wasn't she brilliant? Isn't she? Don't you still have her photography in your room?
Irene Adler.
Norton.
Lady M. Worthley, I really don't know what to say. I'm absolutely annoyed, and I'm not used to being annoyed as much as this.
I'm sorry, Mom.
Do be quiet, girl. You don't know what you've done. You have not only abused the trust your parents and this school have put into you, you have not broken several of this school's rules. You left school early in the morning without alarms to do so. You traveled to London alone. God knows what could have happened on the way there and in London. All this would be enough to remove you from this school. Your parents trusted you to us, to me. We are responsible for your education and your health. I just don't see how we can do it if you behave this willfully. I just don't see it. You are hopeless. I'm deeply disappointed.
I'm truly sorry, Mom.
No, you will be truly sorry when I'm finished with you and hand you over to your prefect and your house teacher for punishment. You're a thoughtless young girl, and you will learn what price you'll have to pay for disobedience. What is worse than all the before-mentioned things is that you then went to an outsider in London and told him a lot of rubbish about problems you think we have at this school. And then you brought him here so that he can poke his nose into everything, and I must deal with him. As if this school did not have enough trouble with a missing teacher and radical women haters who would love to close it down because they say we're doing unnatural things by teaching women to think. Apparently, we have not been successful with you. You don't think, you act, and then you leave the thinking to us.
Mom!
Oh, you be quiet, girl! You don't know the least what you've done! Miss Beckenham, take her away and sign the punishment. But it must be a hard one, so that she learns never to do it again.
So she's not removed from the school?
No, not yet. Fortunately, nothing happened to her. She will learn.
All right, Mom.